Well, good morning. I welcome members to the 13th meeting in 2016 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. As always, I ask members to switch off mobile phones, please. Agenda item one is a decision on taking business in private. It's proposed the committee takes item five in private. This will enable the committee to consider a draft legacy paper. Does the committee agree to take item five in private, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Agenda item number two is the Abusive, Behaviour and Sexual Harm Scotland Bill. And this item is for the committee to consider the delegated powers provisions in the bill following stage two. Members will have before them a briefing on delegated powers in the bill as revised at stage two and a letter from the Cabinet Secretary of Justice concerning relevant stage three amendments. At stage two, a new delegated power was added to section 19.8. Section 19 provides the court, which is hearing the matter, with powers to vary, renew or discharge a sexual harm prevention order. The hearing must be held in specific circumstances. The power in section 19.8 enables rules of court to provide for the time limit within which the person against whom the order has effect, or the chief constable or the prosecutor, as the case may be, may give notice to the sheriff of their wish for a hearing to take place. Any resulting rules of court would be laid before the Parliament, but not subject to further procedure. Section 19.7 and 19.8 are currently drafted and contain, contain an error. The power has been drafted to relate to the time period for giving notice to a sheriff of a wish for a hearing to be held before the sheriff determines the application. The first line of section 19.7 also refers to a sheriff. However, in accordance with section 19.1 and 3, the court which hears an application for variation, renewal or discharge of a sexual harm prevention order may be the appropriate court, being either the High Court of Justiciary or a sheriff, depending on the proceedings. The committee may wish to note that the Scottish Government has lodged amendments at stage three, so that sections 19.7 and 19.8 would refer to an application made to and notice to the appropriate court instead of to a sheriff court only. Does the committee agree that the power in section 19.8 is acceptable in principle and wish to be content that the rules of court would be laid but not subject to any further procedure?
Yes.
Does the committee agree to note the error in section 19.7 and 19.8 and the Scottish Government's stage three amendments which will rectify this?
Yes.
Does the committee agree to report that it is content with the remaining new or substantially revised delegated powers after stage two of the bill?
Yes.
Thank you. Brings us to agenda item three, which is the Burial and Cremation Scotland Bill. This item is for the committee to consider further the delegated powers provisions in the bill following stage two. I wrote to the Scottish Government after our last meeting, setting out the committee's concerns on section 66, which contains a revised power allowing Scottish ministers to make regulations for or in connection with a licensing scheme for funeral directors' businesses. Given the potential impact that the scheme could have on individuals, the committee considered the matters relating to the licensing of funeral directors' businesses should be set out more fully on the face of the bill. Recognising that this might not be possible due to time constraints, the committee asked the Scottish Government to consider attaching an enhanced affirmative procedure to the power. The Scottish Government has yesterday lodged an amendment so that an enhanced affirmative procedure will apply to that power. So do members agree to note and welcome this response from the Scottish Government? Stuart.
I think that's an excellent result and indicates that the government has listened to the concerns of the committee. And I think throughout the passage of this bill, we've seen the committee make a very positive contribution to this particular bill. And I'm glad the government has listened. And I'm glad that we've had the first-class advice from our clerks and advisers that has enabled us to achieve this result.
Good. Thank you. John.
I agree with everything that Stuart Stevenson has said and welcome this final amendment as proposed by the government, which I think leaves us as a committee much more content with the bill at this stage than we were when we were first introduced to it.
Thank you very much. And then come on to agenda item four, which is our annual report. This is consideration of a draft annual report for the parliamentary year from the 11th of May 2015 to the 23rd of March 2016. Under Rule 12.9 of Standing Orders, the committee is obliged to report to the Parliament at the end of each parliamentary year on its activities during that year. We have before us a draft annual report for the parliamentary year 2015-16. Do members have any comments on that report, please? Stuart?
Just a very minor comment that I think the last sentence of paragraph three should read, the bill will be debated at stage three, rather than the current words.
Indeed. I'm sure that's the standard form of words, and I'm sure we'll adopt that. Thank you. Do members have any other comments on that item? Or, for that matter, given that I think this is the last item of the open session of what is likely to be our last meeting in this session, we may have one next Tuesday if required, but that seems unlikely. Do members have any comments? John?
Just say it comes as quite a surprise to me, and notwithstanding the fact that we have been busy, to discover that we have actually considered 323 statutory instruments, if I've read it correctly, in the year, as well as everything else that we've done. I would put it on record as thanking our clerks and legal advisers for all the help that we have had in our consideration of those matters.
Leslie?
I just want to say thank you to all the committee staff, and especially for helping me to get up to speed very quickly. I really appreciate all the effort that's been put into all the reports, and it's been very helpful, and for the additional support. Thank you.
Thank you. Stuart?
I just would like to take the opportunity, convener, of contributing to this to ensure we have unanimity in our praise for our clerks and advisers. It is hard-earned and well-deserved.
Indeed. Well, if I might take the opportunity as the convener, I would like to echo that. If I could possibly embarrass our clerks and legal advisers, I will willingly do so. I don't know whether they're embarrassable. Maybe when you've been in Parliament advising MSPs for a while, you cease being embarrassable. I don't know. But I think they are absolutely fab. They have done an extraordinarily good job, not just for this committee, but also for the government, in picking up all sorts of stuff that normal people do not pick up. Their patience is obvious. Their skills, frankly, proverbial. And as I say, if that embarrasses them, well, so be it. I would also like, and again, that this is the last opportunity, to thank those around us, the official report, those who are in broadcasting, those who attend to all the technicalities which just seem to work, and we're very, very grateful, to our security officers, one here at the moment who represents all the others. Just thank you very much for giving us an environment in which we can do this. I'd also like to thank, actually, Geoff Fitzpatrick and his predecessors as Minister for Parliament, because actually what's happened here has been a dialogue with the government. And I'm sure that Ewan, our clerk, would also recognise that his counterparts in the government actually listen to what he says, and we have a dialogue which enables an awful lot of these changes to be achieved. So I'm hoping I've not left anybody out, other than to thank fellow members for your diligence over the last session. Mostly. We've been incredibly busy. A small crew has actually made it work very, very well, but only because you've engaged enormously well with it. So thank you very much. John?
I would also like to thank you, convener, for your sympathetic and intelligent chairing of this committee over the last 5 years. I think you've done a very good job, and it's it's down to you in large measure, the fact that this committee has worked so well together and by and large and spoken with one voice, in fact almost without exception spoken with one voice, and I think that's down to your thoughtful and sympathetic chairing of this group as well. So I thank you for your convenership of this committee over the last 5 years.
Right, well, thank you for those kind words. I think that brings us to the end of agenda item four, somewhat extended, and at that point I move the meeting into private.